Last video went pretty well, I think. We talked about how to speed up combat by letting the players track damage done to the monsters instead of the dungeon master tracking monster current hit points or whatever. And a whole bunch of people in the comments and on Twitter in the days afterwards said that they tried it. It was a huge success, a huge weight lifted off their shoulders. That makes me incredibly happy, knowing that something that I figured out in my experimentation is helping other people. Of course, it's not for everybody. Some people reject the idea as soon as they hear it, just like they're going to do to this one. I figured we'd do a sequel to that and talk about one other way I know to speed up combat that is a lot of fun for me and my friends. Actually, there are a lot of ways to speed up combat that I'm sure many of you know about. But if you're a new Dungeon Master, which is sort of our shtick here, this is the thing we talk about, is you should run D&D. It's fun. You will like it. It's not that hard. And if combat seems to drag on and be a kind of tedious, there are lots of little tiny tweaks you can do at the table that will speed things up. For instance, you can have your players, or ask your players, to roll their attack roll and their damage dice at the same time. It saves one whole step, and it may not seem like a lot, but it seriously adds up over several players and several rounds of combat and a couple of combats per night. Something else we can do that will speed things up, actually it's a thing that players do, I do it, that slows things down, is they roll their 20-sided die and they announce the number, and then the Dungeon Master begins doing the math and announces the result, and then the player says, but wait, that was what I rolled, that wasn't my total. So for instance, the player rolls an 11, and the Dungeon Master says, wait, 11, no, that misses, and the player goes, wait, that's what I rolled, I actually got a 50, and the Dungeon Master goes, okay, that hits. And you know, that happens once or twice, it's not a big deal, but when it's happening regularly across the entire table, it's a huge pain in the butt. So it's just a good to get into the habit of not announcing what you rolled, do the math first, and then tell the Dungeon Master. And I'm going to put a little asterisk there, because actually one of the things I know, depending on the game you're playing, especially earlier editions of Dungeons & Dragons, Pathfinder, third edition 3.5, tend to have a lot of bonuses, right? Because you get a bonus because the bard is singing, you get a bonus because the cleric cast aid, you get +2 because you're flanking, and you end up doing a lot of math. So in situations where one of the nice things about D&D is if you don't want to do the math, you can just roll the 20-sided die and look at the result and then decide whether or not you have to do the math. For instance, if you roll your 20-sided die and you roll a 17 or 18 or 19 or 20, you hit. You're fine. You probably hit. Overwhelmingly likely that you hit. And the Dungeon Master will tell you, wait, I need to know, because this guy actually has some ridiculously high AC. Likewise, if you roll a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 7, you miss, depending on your bonus. You'll know. If you roll a 1, 2, or 3, you definitely miss, right? But if you're at +2 and you rolled a 7, you didn't hit. So you don't need to do any more math. You can just roll your d20 and go, no, and move on. Or alternatively, roll your d20 and go, oh, actually, I got a 17. I don't need to do the math. I know I hit this thing. So there are ranges. That's the great thing about D&D, is there are ranges on either side, and they're pretty substantive, where I know I hit, I know I missed, no math necessary. I realize those two pieces of advice somewhat contradict each other, but that's one of those things where you roll the die and you roll the 1, 2, or 3, you go, move on. Or an 18 or 19 or 20, you're like, I hit, everything's great. You roll a 9 or a 7 and you start having to do a little bit of math. And that's where you don't announce what you rolled, you just go, hang on a minute, it's this number. So that's two or three little pieces of advice, each one of which, if you employ, will speed things up a tiny little bit, but summed over all the players at the table and all the rounds of combat and all the combats in a given evening, it will make a difference. But something else that I have started doing, and I don't know when we started doing this, it was a perfectly natural thing to do, was I elected one of the players to be the Monster Wrangler. The Monster Wrangler is the player at the table, and there's often more than one, that I trust to run the monsters. When I say run the monsters, I mean mostly move them in combat and then position them and then tell me which monsters have attacks on which players. And this is especially useful when you're running hordes of bad guys, goblins, kobolds, orcs, zombies, skeletons, you know, when there's one or two wraiths or shadows or one beholder, you don't need a monster wrangler for that. You want to run the powerful bad guys and you want to make their decisions. But when you've got a powerful bad guy and a whole bunch of minions, I will just ask one of the players, okay, could you do me a favor? It's the monster's turn. Could you just move them in an optimal fashion? And if you have players that are used to playing in a fair sportsmanlike way, something really amazing happens, because the players, first of all, they feel empowered. They feel like they're participating a little bit more than they would if they were just a normal player. And they typically want to return that trust. They want to do a good job getting the monsters. I want these goblins to behave in the most advantageous way possible. It's also kind of fun for the player to challenge their players at the table. It's a huge weight off your shoulders. And often the players, because of the way we sit at these tables, the players have easier access to the monsters. You have to get up and walk around the table and go between them and say, excuse me, move these things. It's also, and I think this is important, there are two other benefits to this, apart from the fact that you save time. One is you're sort of getting one of the players ready to be their own dungeon master. Like, I knew my friend Lars would make a good DM for a lot of reasons, and sort of kind of coach him and get him into it. Without warning, I just told him, hey, you're going to run the skeletons in this combat. And I think I mentioned this in another video a long time ago, but because I wanted Lars was new, unlike some of my friends, like my friend Dave Miles can do it, my friend Jim Murphy can do it, my friend Jordy can do it, and I can just say, it's the goblins' turn. Let me know what they do. And they'll take great joy in trying to get the goblins to behave in a tactically optimal way. And also, you know, somewhat role playing. What would the goblins do? And I don't have to worry about that. But Lars was new. He played a lot of Final Fantasy Tactics, so he understood the principles, but he was a little worried that he might kind of overwhelm the players. And so what I did was I took a 6-sided die. Didn't have to be a D6, could have been a D4. I had a 6-sided die behind the screen. And I said, you know, this is the threat die. When it's at 6, I want you to do everything you can think of, everything in your power to maneuver these monsters in an optimal way to challenge the players. And then I, without having to communicate with Lars, without having to say, hey, let's take it easy on these guys, I could just tick the die down. And when it got down to 4, Lars started making, he didn't have to say anything, he just goes, oh, the die's gone down to 4. And now he starts making decisions in more of a role-playing sense, like, well, I, Lars, know that if this skeleton attacks Phil's character, he will take Phil's character down. But EJ's character just attacked me, so I will take the opportunity to attack EJ's character. And now Lars is starting to think like a dungeon master. And that's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun to say, here is this task that is normally the dungeon master's task. And it's relatively simple and straightforward. It's literally just tactics and strategy on a grid. You don't have to do any role playing. It's not a whole lot of decision making, and give it to one of the players and empower them and get them ready for getting behind the screen. The other thing it does, and this is perhaps non-obvious, is it makes things seem more real. It makes it seem like the behavior of these creatures is not up to the whims of the dungeon master, but that there is a right answer. There is a how would they really behave? And once we're all thinking about that, once we're all building consensus on that, it really starts to feel like you're opening a window and looking into this world, and they're doing this on their own. Obviously, they're not. It's Jim who's doing it, but it no longer feels adversarial. That adversarial notion of it's the players versus the dungeon master starts to go out the window a little bit, and it starts to be more about the goblins and what the goblins would do. And it's hard to argue when you see one of the players saying, well, look, obviously the goblins would try to take down the wizard. You just fireball all of us. So they're going to move in this tactically advantageous way to get to you. And the players are like, yeah, I guess that's what they would do. It doesn't feel like, oh, I, Matt, the dungeon master, I'm angry because this wizard just fireballed all my guys. It ceases to be personal, and it starts to become more this feeling of an objective reality, which is a very subtle thing. And it's not obvious when you go down that road, but it's something I noticed, especially with new players. And it's a lot of fun. And again, it's a huge burden off your shoulders. You've got a lot of work to do, especially if you're like me and you tend to run big, elaborate combats with lots of bad guys, you know, many different tiers of bad guys. It's great to be able to say, okay, all the minions go. Minions with lowercase m or uppercase m, depending on how you run them. The horde of bad guys go. Jim, let me know which ones get attacked. He'll go, okay, great. And he'll do all the moving. And you can hear the players go, oh God, now I'm flanked, or this is happening. Now I can't get to the unconscious player, great. And Jim will say, Matt, goblin number 3 has an attack on Dave. And I'll go, great. And he just reports to me what the goblin, and I'm the one doing all the die rolling, and I'm the one doing all the damage. And if it's a shaman or anything other than a bog standard, you know, savage horde, then I'm the one making the decisions. That's my right. But otherwise, if there's a whole sea of bad guys, why not let one of the players run them? That's it, folks. That's the whole video. Another short video, but I hope has a high utility function. I want to get into the habit of making more shorter videos, because back in the day, when we first got to know each other, I had a full-time job. I would be done with my job at the end of the day. I would come home and I would be like, great, I've got all evening. I can record a video. And that would happen 5 nights a week. And then I would have my entire weekends free. I could record more videos. And sometimes I uploaded several videos a week. It was like Christmas. Unfortunately, now I'm the head of a company and we have a product to finish. And of the 4 people who work at this company, including me, I'm the only one who can do the writing. So the Strongholds and Followers manuscript weighs heavy on my head. But I make progress all the time. And it's also, even when I'm not working on it, it's hard to kind of give myself permission, if you understand what I'm saying, to kind of do anything else like this. So I want to get into the habit of, even if it's not a D&D video, I know this is going to break some people's hearts, even if it's not a D&D video, even if something short and silly, I want to make sure we're uploading content at least once a week. And if I can think of something short and interesting, don't worry, there's going to be a lot more in the game videos. I've got a whole list here of cool stuff to talk about and a whole backlog of stuff that we're going to catch up to, but got to get the Strongholds and Followers manuscript done. A whole bunch of things rely on that happening, and I don't want to let people down. Also, something I've been horribly neglecting, because I think Lars and I, between the two of us, had decided maybe they don't want us to do this because they don't want to get flooded with people saying, hey, can you produce my tiny run of minis? But the folks doing our miniatures, the folks printing our miniatures, is a company called Trenchworks in Utah. They're awesome. We flew up there. I spent the day up there. I got to meet everybody. I got to see their process. I wish I could have taken video. It would have made a great video, but their process actually is kind of secret. And it's a really amazing company. I hope I'm not telling tales outside of school, but they basically make robots. There's like their company, their whole warehouse is like split in two. And over here, we make robots that assemble things for the medical industry. And then over here, we have our alchemical laboratory that has like all these pots with bubbling stuff inside them where they make our minis. And they're awesome. And we have a great relationship with those guys. And I honestly have no idea how we would have got, well, actually, we would have had to find somebody else. But I have a sneaking suspicion we would not enjoy working with whoever else we were going with and the guys at Trenchworks. So thanks to Dave and the guys at Trenchworks. They're all super awesome. It was a blast being out there in Utah. Credit where it's due. And it's everyone on my end of the screen thinks that this is the beginning of a long and beautiful friendship. So mote it be. Don't be surprised if you see more videos from me this week that in some cases are just really short. We're not going to do much more working on the campaign until the Strongholds and Followers manuscript is closer to being done. But we will get there, and the playtest is going fantastically. So thank you for being patient. I know it's sort of counterintuitive. We raised a whole bunch of money. All of a sudden, no more videos, right? But everything we're doing now is in preparation for being able to make a whole lot of videos and make them regularly. So we'll get more tours of the office. I filmed us assembling the table. I'm going to edit that down so you folks can see it. Really excited about everything that's happening and just excited for the future and really looking forward to getting this manuscript done. That's it, folks. Until next time, peace out. If I were to be made a knight, said the wart, staring dreamily into the fire, I should insist on doing my vigil by myself, as Hob does with his hawks. And I should pray to God to let me encounter all the evil in the world in my own person, so that if I conquered, there would be none left. And if I were defeated, I would be the one to suffer for it. That would be extremely presumptuous of you, said Merlin. And you would be conquered. And you would suffer for it. I shouldn't mind.